weather is crazy. Forests are disappearing. A lot of people do not have food, while others eat too much. The population keeps growing, and there are more and more wars and people who are forced to leave their homes. We pollute our environment and throw away our food.
The BCFN is a multidisciplinary think tank created to deal with all the food and nutrition challenges we face. Together we can understand, act, and change.
Tomorrow depends on what we eat today. Leave us a better world.
Fixing the Business of Food, the Food Industry, and the SDG Challenge, New York, September 24, 2019.
And that's the question. How do we do this? Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Gerda Verburg. I'm the coordinator of the Scaling Up Nutrition Movement. I'm testing the micro, but the people from the Technique have promised that they will do an excellent job, so we count on each other. But I'd like to welcome you to this event. Thank you for coming. We are anticipating to have a very exciting event. Most of you are already running up and down New York, because it's better to run up and down or walk up and down than taking a taxi at this very moment. But you made it here at around 4 o'clock. We have 2 hours, and we have a very attractive program, because we have time for interaction, and we have a mixed audience or participants, like I used to say. And I first would like to check who is coming from where. Who is here on behalf of the civil society? Well, not too bad. Who is coming from the private sector? Very good. Good, 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 good. UN organizations. Right, good presentation. And the government, who's coming from governments? All right, a little bit a minority, but you can speak up, and then we also have a conversation with the government. All right, ladies and gentlemen, so then we know a little bit the background of you as participants. But before we start the program, I would like to ask you, please put your cell phone on silence, or even better, press the button to be not disturbed during this event. Secondly, this event is being recorded. Invitation to use fixing food if you are using your. So it's please use fixing food if you are on social media. I think that was I'm also already up and running from very long today. But be welcome to use your device, your cell phone or whatever, to use social media, but not making phone calls or checking emails. Thank you very much. But we start this event in a loving memory for Luca Virginio. We wish to dedicate this event to him, Luca. He was the vice chairman of the Barilla Foundation, who suddenly passed away last week. He inspired the work of the foundation, playing a key role in building its pathway towards sustainable development. So let's make sure together that we continue to do what he started to do, be inspired to make it happen, to have sustainable food that is nutritious and sustainably produced, making sure that we leave no one behind. Then we move on to the program. And first of all, I would like to give the floor to Guido Barilla to speak the opening words of this session. Guido, you have the floor.
Good afternoon, and thank you all of you for attending today. It is a great pleasure to welcome such distinguished speakers and to co-host this workshop on sustainable practices in the food sector. As a brief introduction, you have seen a little contribution just a little while ago of the Barilla Center for Food and Nutrition Foundation, was launched 10 years ago to better understand and share knowledge about the food chain, from production to waste, consumption, and sustainability. We have created an international multidisciplinary center of high-level experts who tackle complex issues. Our aim is then to translate these complex issues into simple messages and proposals so the people outside of this room, those who are not as involved as experts but have an interest, so they can start to understand how we can make changes that will help our world. Today, we are launching a new report on the changes that the food industry needs to make, entitled Fixing the Business of Food, the Food Industry and the SDG Challenges. It is the first one of a two-year program. It has been a pleasure to work with our three partners: the Sustainable Development Solution Network, Columbia Center for Sustainable Investments, and the Santa Chiara Lab of University of Siena. Our planet is crying out for us to make these changes. This summer we have seen all the pictures of the people battling with the smog and air pollution in our city, with its associated death that now numbering 7 million citizens each year. Natural disasters such as hurricanes devastated areas, causing failed crops and food shortages. Out of control forest fires destroyed habitats across 5 continents. Together with our partners, we set ourselves the challenge of assessing the food industry progress to date in aligning with the Sustainable Development Goals and the 2030 Agenda. We know that it's time for a transformation to sustainable food and land use. Now we need to step up and explain how our industry will do this. Many food industry leaders have already taken important steps towards alignment with the SDGs, but much more work is needed to address the challenges. Businesses are, of course, responsible to their owners, but they are also responsible to their customers, employers, suppliers, and the communities and the nations where they operate. In the food industry and more broadly, together with upstream suppliers and downstream customers, businesses are co-responsible for the environmental and social sustainability of their global supply chain. After this workshop, I will return to my job in Parma and my role of a businessman. At Barilla, we warmly accept the new responsibilities and accountabilities of the SDGs. Yet, in practice, it is difficult to apply these principles. In our boardrooms, we have to be not only tough leaders, but decision makers as well. And it is a challenge that this report tries to simplify for the CEOs. It recommends that we should ask ourselves 4 guiding questions. The first one: does the company contribute to health and sustainable dietary patterns through its product and strategy? The second: are the company's production process economically, socially, and environmentally sustainable? The third: are the company's global supply chains sustainable? And the fourth: it is the company a good citizen? I leave you with a reminder of why this is worth the effort. The food industry must transform to align with the Sustainable Development Goals. And I know that together we can do it. And it's time really to take action. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Guido Barella from Barella, and also the chairman of the Barella Foundation. Barella Foundation, together with the Sustainable Development Network, has organized this event, so I'm extremely happy to now invite to take the floor Mr. Jeffrey Sachs. He's a university professor from the Columbia University, and he's the director of the SDSN. So I think everybody knows you because you're quite vocal on the sustainable development goals, and good for you. Just like Barella is setting the scene for how to decide in the boardroom, you are always able to critically reflect where we are. You have the floor.
Yep. Okay. I'll use this one. Thank you very much, and Guido, thank you so much for the enormous pleasure and honor and delight to be working with you and to be working with the Barella Center on Food and Nutrition. It's a fantastic foundation. It's a great mission, and for us at the Sustainable Development Solutions Network, a wonderful opportunity to really tackle some great challenges. And it's fantastic to hear your words as one of the world leaders, one of the iconic companies of the food industry, speaking so clearly and importantly about what needs to be done. It's not easy to feed the planet. I think this is really the starting point. There are 7.7 billion people on the planet, and they all need to be well fed every day. That's a lot of people and an incredible challenge. And we're not achieving it. And we're not achieving it in certain very important ways, identifiable shortfalls that are rather critical now. So what are we not accomplishing? First, unfortunately, of the 7.7 billion people on the planet, arguably most are not well nourished. And that is a stunning truth. 1 billion people are hungry every day, undernourished in terms of caloric intake and in terms of protein sufficiency, basic chronic hunger. And then we know, not precisely, but perhaps another 1 billion or so are lacking vital micronutrients, whether it's vitamins or essential amino acids or the right kinds of lipids. The diet is imbalanced in a way that is leading to important micronutrient deficiencies. Sadly, we don't have precision on that, though we know that these deficiencies are very widespread. Then we know that we are in the midst of a shocking epidemic of metabolic disease and obesity that seems to be related, is likely related to the food industry. And I think the most plausible arguments are that the ultra-processed foods, the foods with heavy sugar additives, the highly processed grains and so forth, have become such a high proportion of diets, the snack foods, the ready-to-eat foods, that they're killing us. They're killing people in very large numbers. And in the United States, it's unbelievable. 40% obesity rates, and this is not been addressed in public health terms, nor by the industry. And many of our iconic brands are almost surely deeply implicated in this. So that's one part of the challenge, that 3 or 4 billion people out of the 7.7 billion are not getting a decent diet. Then is the production of food. The Amazon was on fire this summer and continues to be on fire. And President Bolsonaro made a perfectly obnoxious speech at the UN today, defending his sovereignty. There is no sovereignty to burn down a rainforest. And that kind of bluster is completely unacceptable. He was followed by an even worse leader, who I won't discuss right now. But the fact of the matter is you don't have a right to burn down the forest. And he should have been appealing for global help, for scientific cooperation to understand what to do. But surely one part of it is producers of beef or producers of soybeans or others pushing into the forest margins. It's not the only thing. There's also illegal mining, and there are many other activities taking place. But we know that agriculture is pushing against ecosystems all over the world to an absolutely shocking extent. A few months ago, we had the report of the biodiversity panel, which said that about 1 million species are being pushed to extinction right now by human activity. We're losing the ecosystems. Of course, it's complex. It requires good science to understand what are the drivers. But agriculture is certainly the lead driver. And there's very little accountability in general, because the way global supply chains are legally organized is that there are those who do the destruction and then commodities that are purchased for world market. And there's a corporate divide between the two and a lack of accountability and traceability in general. And when Guido said that Barilla recognizes the responsibility of a company across the whole global supply chain, that's saying an enormous amount. That's not rhetoric. That is a fundamental change of how our world economy could work in the right direction, because co-responsibility is the most important message in a global supply chain. And we have other wonderful industry leaders here, Andrea Illy, whose products I enjoy several times a day, who also speaks about the responsibility of the great coffee roasters for the coffee production and the smallholder production of coffee. And Mario Cerruti of Lavazza is here someplace, VP of Lavazza.
Before you start to welcome everybody separately.
I want to welcome friends because they're great leaders in this. Great leaders. Okay, but the point I want to make is how important this idea is, because we will not get sustainability on the planet unless there is co-responsibility. So the agriculture system is the most important driver of anthropogenic change, unfortunately. Global warming, loss of ecosystems, chemical pollutants. And then the final point I want to make is that it is also the most vulnerable sector to the changes underway. We are going to lose the resiliency of the food sector itself if climate change, loss of biodiversity, destruction of land, scarcity of water continues the direction we're going. It's not only that the food sector drives those changes, but it is the first victim of those changes as well. So it's not easy to feed 7.7 billion people. At the rate we're going, adding about 80 million people a year, we will soon be at 8 billion, we'll be at 8.5 or 9 billion, and it's going to be a lot harder. The point of everything this week is to think ahead. This requires new kinds of corporate performance, new kinds of metrics, and new kinds of politics. And so if there's one message I would have is to be farsighted in what we're doing, understand the implications, measure them, monitor them, and use them to change course. And that's the purpose of this study in its first phase, to indicate what should be done. And I want to thank again the Barilla Center for promoting this work, for undertaking it, for leading it, and for making such a wonderful contribution. Thank you very much.
Thank you. He's taking a micro. That's a little bit dangerous, huh? Yes, I know, but I'll give you the floor at a certain moment. I'm quite sure about it. Thank you very much for setting the scene together with Guido Barilla. Then I am happy to invite to the podium Scarlett Benson. Where is Scarlett Benson?
Hello.
Hello. Yes, please. She is from the Food and Land Use Coalition, huge coalition. Also, many friends here in the room, but I don't want to greet
all of them.
Yes, all right, very good. You are going to talk about the 10 critical transitions to transform food and land use. I would like to invite you to talk a little bit about the how. Because we know how daunting it is. That is exactly why all the people came to this event, to learn more about the how to do this. You have the floor for the next 8 minutes.
Great, okay. Lovely to meet you all. Thank you for having me here. So my name's Scarlett Benson, and I'm the Program Manager of the Food and Land Use Coalition, and I recently co-authored a report that was launched last week called Growing Better, 10 Critical Transitions for Transforming Food and Land Use Systems. So, hold on 1 second. So the report, I think, is somewhere around, perhaps outside. We've got 2 big boxes, so please take copies so I don't have to carry them back to my hotel. Just very briefly on the Food and Land Use Coalition, we've got the logos of all the different members and the donors on that slide there. I think we have WBCSD in the room, and SDSN, of course, and perhaps some others. So,
more.
Yeah. basically the report, lovely pictures here, is the first global integrated assessment of social, health, and environmental benefits associated with food and land use systems. So all the reports that Jeff was mentioning, the IPBS report, the IPCC report, is absolutely builds on those reports. I've been asked to talk about the how, so I won't go into all the horrible information about what sort of nightmarish situation we're walking into, because I think we all know the facts there. But what this does is brings together all of that, all of those studies, and looks at how can we achieve all of these different benefits. So for me, what was unique about the report, and it's always the question that journalists seem to be asking, not another report. Everybody seems to be bandying the word report fatigue around. But I think what's really unique about this is that we prove that there is no trade-off between environmental health, inclusion, and food security outcomes. So into a bit of the substance, this is a piece of an economic analysis that we conducted, which looks at the hidden costs of today's food and land use systems. So the hidden costs are essentially the externalities or the inefficiencies associated with the system. So on the left-hand side, you can see the market value of today's food and land use systems at $10 trillion US dollars. And then as you go along, these are the hidden costs. So you can see in the light blue, the hidden costs associated with health is actually $6.6 trillion a year. And that's to do with obesity, undernutrition, as well as antimicrobial resistance as well. So for me, coming from an environmental background, this was actually hugely interesting that health was the biggest biggest hidden cost. And I think it's actually a really exciting opportunity to reframe some of these topics and to re-engage and liven up the discussion about how we can tackle environmental challenges with an approach that puts diet and health at the heart of it. So, okay, how, which I've been asked to talk about. So we have identified 10 critical transitions for transforming food and land use systems. And these critical transitions are we put them in a pyramid, and as you can see, healthy diets is at the top of that pyramid. And that's really because we believe that what 9 billion, 10 billion people choose to eat and how they are influenced potentially to make those decisions about what they eat is actually going to ignite this whole reform agenda. So without shifting diets, none of this stuff is possible. I'm not going to go through every 10 transition. I'd love you to read the report. But there, within each transition, we set out recommendations for business, for government, for the financial community, as well as civil society. We include lots of really great examples of where businesses, many businesses in the room, are already leading and showing that change is possible. So if you look at the boxes on the left-hand side, you've got the economic prize. Now, the economic prize that we've identified is 5.7 trillion a year by 2030 and 10.5 trillion by 2050. So that economic prize is essentially the reduction in the hidden costs associated with implementing the reform agenda that we outline. The investment requirements, it's $300 to $350 billion a year between now and 2030. And then there's also a business opportunity, $4.5 trillion a year associated with these transitions. So if you look at the economic prize and the investment analysis, it's actually a 15 to 1 ratio, return ratio. So we really think this is the best deal on the planet, and it creates huge opportunities for businesses that want to be part of the solution. Great, so I'm just going to go into one last slide because I think, you know, I've described these critical transitions, and you might be thinking, how on earth is it possible that we can achieve food security, bring people out of poverty, feed everybody on the planet, all the environmental objectives as well as health objectives? So this slide shows, if you look at the left-hand side, you have the breakdown of land today on Earth. And then in the middle, you have the breakdown of land by 2050 if we continue doing things the way that we're doing. And then the one on the right-hand side, if we implement this reform agenda. Now, if we continue as we're going, we're going to deforest 400 million more hectares of natural ecosystem for agricultural land. That's twice the size of Mexico. But if we can implement this reform agenda, then we'll actually save 1.2 billion hectares of land that is currently used for agriculture, and that land will be available to return to nature. So that will allow us to sequester more carbon, achieve all the biodiversity benefits. So this is a really interesting finding, and it's definitely a slide that lots of people have, that's piqued people's interest, because freeing up land by changing our diets, by reducing food loss and waste, and improving agricultural productivity through better use of technology, et cetera, actually enables us to use land more efficiently. So one of the key things in the report is that we're really urging people to recognize that land has an opportunity cost and that it's, you know, an essential asset for us. So I have many more exhibits like this, things that go into protein, into bioenergy, and a lot of these are produced in coordination with the International Institute for Applied Systems Analysis, IASA, who did all the modeling. So we're very happy to share all of the analysis. But I just wanted to show you this one because I think it's a really nice exhibit. So just finally, very happy to answer any questions and go into more detail on the critical transitions. And just personal note from me, I think I mentioned report fatigue at the beginning of this my few words, and I do believe that this report is actually quite inspiring because it is very focused on what we need to do and how we need to bring everybody together. So I do implore you all to read it. It's really inspired me, and I hope it will inspire you too. Thank you very much.
No, wait. Stand for a moment, please. Yes. Give her a big hand, because indeed, it's amazing what I found, but I have invited you, Scarlett, to talk a little bit about how to get there, how to start the implementation, because that is what is triggering us. If you are telling us that there is no trade-off, why isn't it already happening? And my question is how to start to implement this? Well, answer the question, please.
Okay. I will answer the question.
Answer.
No, I would say the first thing is that there's a lot of myths around, things that people believe are these trade-offs, that you can't have environmental sustainability and feed everybody. So the first thing is around knowledge, and I just think trying to bust those myths and help people to understand more about the options and the reform agenda. I also think it's about building successful coalitions. So at the Food and Land Use Coalition, we have these 10 critical transitions. For us, the report is purely a vehicle for us to start to bring people together and actually implement changes. So businesses are absolutely essential. We have a whole host of recommendations for business of things that they can implement.
I come a little bit closer because this answer is a little bit too general.
Too general.
Yes. Who needs to take the lead here?
All of
because
you. No, really what I would say is that we started off writing the report, and actually we were saying that policymakers were the only ones that could really implement this. But actually, without business supporting policymakers, I think it's impossible.
I think you're right. Thank you very much. Big hand for Scarlett Benson. Please, thank you very much. Because I think this is a crucial thing. Private sector companies have to play an important role. But it is crucial for the Sustainable Development Goals, and Jeffrey Sachs will confirm this, that governments take the leadership and show the ownership and are able to set the enabling environment. But to do this, we need a lot of research, but researchers and people with propositions and proposals need to understand the political economy. My contribution for the discussion. We will continue to talk about it, also based upon your questions. First of all, and we are extremely curious to hear from him, Angelo Riccaboni, and he will talk about the role of businesses to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. And I'm going to invite you to do the same. Talk also a little bit about the how. Not only the what need to be done, but also how to get it done, or where to start.
Thank you, Gerda. Thank you, everybody. I'm very pleased to be here and to share with you the first results of our initiative, Fixing the Business of Food initiative. And in particular, you said we need to focus on the how, also because after the illuminating speeches by Jeffrey Sachs, Guido Barilla, and Scarlett, we all know which are the challenges. So I don't get back to the challenges. What I would like to say, however, is that there's a growing awareness that business can contribute to sustainable food, water, oceans, and land. This is in line with the so-called multi-stakeholder management, corporate management, which was also endorsed recently by the Business Roundtable. But differently from other sectors, here we have a strong relevance of the supply chain. So the issue of co-responsibility is a key issue for this sector, because leaders or companies important in any supply chain share co-responsibility with their upstream suppliers and with the downstream customers about the environmental, social, and also economic performance of the entire supply chain. So this is a key issue in the sector. So you were right, we need to talk about how, and we will make some proposals, but before that, what is sure is that the food industry by itself cannot make it, cannot address the challenges in front of us. We need partnerships. So the first answer to your question is that food industry, food companies, need to work with governments, as you mentioned, with academia, with public opinion in general, with the consumers. That is extremely important. So, but the point of the report, of our initiative, is to see what companies do, because in order to improve, in order to say what to do, we need to better understand what companies are doing. So this is the key part of our work, to see what companies are doing, and also how performances are monitored, because as we all know, what is measured gets done. So we need to see what companies do, but also how they disclose their performances. So this is the reason why, for research centers join efforts in order to work together to aim at these two goals, to see if and how the food industry is progressing towards SDGs, but also to provide recommendations about what should be done in line with the achievement of Agenda 2030. In order to do that, we decided to define this kind of a framework, and in particular to assess if companies are in line with SDGs, we ask to answer to these four questions. So this is a little bit in your direction. Eh? So the first question is, does the company contribute to healthy and sustainable dietary patterns through its products and strategy? So is the company providing reasons, tools, and products, and also making public aware that what is really important are sustainable diets? So sustainable and healthy dietary patterns. Second question, how the company performs in terms of its internal processes? I mean, are they sustainable from an economic, social, and environmental perspective? Third question is, what about the supply chain? Is the supply chain sustainable? Because as I said before, we need the issue of co-responsibility means that a company needs to be held accountable also for its supply chain. Fourth, is the corporate a good citizen? Is it transparent? They are treating workers in the right way? Do they pay taxes where it operates? So these are the four dimensions, the four pillars of alignment we are working on. So we decided to have a field study or a study on the field to better understand how things work. So we decided to start with major food companies, and we thought that it was nice to start from the ones with a good reputation in terms of sustainability. But we are not saying which are the better, but we refer to indicators or analysis by others. In particular, we chose both public companies and private companies. We referred to large companies, at least 3 billion euros, 2 billion euros of revenues, 1.5 billion euros of fixed assets. And according to the Reuters database, we have in the world 300 companies. So out of them, we use some major indicators for major rankings on sustainability. We applied these rankings, and we arrived to a sample of 80, including private companies chosen according to their experience in sustainability reporting. So we try to use objective quotes indicators. So out of the 80 of the final set, we chose 10 to balance sector of activities, country of origin, governance structure. And we studied this company, and we produce for each of them a report on what they are doing. We also took into consideration which are the most used sustainability reporting mechanism and monitoring mechanism, because the way you disclose your performances is very important, and we wanted to understand which were the most important issues for companies through such exercise. So what emerged in terms of, for instance, use of indicators or performance measurements, it is shown by this table. This table is a complex table, but this is the contribution of this table, because it shows that if we cross the four dimensions, the four pillars, with the accountability tools used by companies, we see that companies, here we aggregated all of them, are using many, many mechanisms. And this is a clear indication that it's difficult to compare, it's difficult to set high targets, because you have different measurements, you have a lot of complexity. you can see here that we also subdivided the set of tools in two parts. I don't want to go into details, but one is more principle-based, one is more specific for the sector. But anyway, at the end, the story is that even those which with greater reputation use different and not homogeneous tools. So which is the out of it, which are the basic conclusions? So the basic conclusion is that at least the 10 companies we analyzed, they are working on the four dimensions we chose as object of analysis. So this is good. And they also, with some differences, endorse sustainable development as a core business concept. And also they make reference to co-responsibility of the supply chain. I would like to underscore the issue of co-responsibility. However, what emerged is that what they report is mainly idiosyncratic and not complete. This means that companies tend to pick areas where they perform better, and they do not consider all the items, all the dimensions that are important for us to better understand if the companies are aligned with the SDGs. In our opinion, in the opinion of the team is made up of researchers from four research centers, BCFN, SDSN, Barilla Center for Food and Nutrition, Sustainable Development Solutions Network, and the Columbia Center for Sustainable Investments, and the Santa Chiara Lab at the University of Siena. So we were working with the idea that it is important to have information about source country and about product line. These two issues are important. So I have in mind your question, how?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
To us, it's important to, I'm anticipating you, it is important to ask companies to be more precise on this issue, because then we hope that they will behave better. So source country, which is important also to match with the national policies, of course, and product line are two areas where companies can do better. Also, what is not adequately detailed is which are the impacts of products on health and well-being of customers. Jeffrey mentioned the epidemics in terms of nutrition. I mean, we would like to see, and we suggest to have more information on this dimension. Also, what is clear is that in terms of corporate citizenship, companies, they describe in a narrative form, but some details are lacking. In particular, there are not many quantitative results or data, which is for us very important. Last but not least, I think that is very, very interesting. Companies tend to set targets. They like to say by 2030, by 2025, but then they usually use different criteria, different indicators, different time frames. That's good, but makes very, very difficult to compare, which is a very important exercise. I would like to add that we did our analysis in the period January 1st, June 30th. So now we come to the recommendations, Gerda.
Oh.
That's good?
Yeah, that's good.
That's
but
good.
You have 3 minutes for the concrete recommendations on the how.
Okay.
Because you're addressing a lot of things also in the room, but we need to focus on the how.
On the how, recommendation. Yes. First, we feel comfortable with our four dimensions framework, so I don't need to repeat which are the four dimensions. Second recommendation, we need to work on harmonizing monitoring standards and reporting systems, and that is very, very important. And we know that there are very useful platforms like GRI, like WBCSD. So there are many platforms, and we would like to cooperate with them in order to promote harmonization in reporting and in monitoring systems. So that is very important, and this is one step, to build the possibility to work together in order to improve this mechanism. Second, we would like to see that these monitoring agencies are independent financially, which is a key issue to avoid any problem. Third recommendation, we ask company to work on the improvement of their products, to reformulate their composition in line with the indication by international organizations on health, but also it is important to use, quote, companies to make the public more aware of a healthy diet and lifestyle. So it means that companies are powerful tools or powerful media in order to promote information, the right information to have people use healthy and sustainable dietary patterns. Last recommendation concerns the supply chain. The supply chain is extremely important, so companies should take advantage of digital support. We all know about blockchain, but there are also other solutions in order to keep the track of what is happening along the entire supply chain. So that is a very important issue to make the companies more and more aware of the importance to track the entire supply chain. And also, companies can be, and this is another answer to your request, companies can be a driver to promote innovation also in the smallholder farms, also in their small suppliers, because as we all know, the food sector is made up of small companies. They have a really difficult access to innovation, and the leaders in the supply chain can support more innovation in these companies. That is something which is already happening, but should happen even more. I'm going to the next steps.
No? You're finalizing. So you give some topics that you want to be discussed further, because we need to move on.
If you think that what we can do more, even more practical, so yeah. I can make a sort of a list.
Yeah. Three things.
Okay.
Yes.
One, to work together with existing platforms to make reporting and monitoring more concrete, which is very important. Secondly, we know that partnerships are becoming more and more relevant, so to promote these partnerships, and also to work more on the definition of purposes, business models, and which are the programming systems within companies, which is not an easy task, but that is something that is needed. So there are both general level recommendations, but also we need to work more within companies. And in order to do that, we need to go ahead with the collection of the experience in the field.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Big hand for Angelo Riccaboni. And we know this is the first report of a series, and we need the input of all from all of you and the collaboration from all of you to make it possible to write a second report and a third report. In the meantime, we have two more participants in the room, and I don't know whether you were here already from the very beginning. Your Excellency Emanuela Claudia Del Re, Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs and the International Cooperation of Italy, and Director General of FAO Chu, you also arrived. I give you the floor, but I would like to invite you to leave your speech behind and to elaborate how governments can take the lead in encouraging and softly push a little bit private sector companies in the whole food and land use sector to become more responsible and more healthy and more sustainable, both when it comes towards to people and the planet. And I'm quite sure both of you can do it. First of all, Emanuela Claudia Del Re, Vice Minister of Foreign Affairs. She's smuggling in her speech. So let's see what will happen.
I'm making my speech.
Okay.
As a reference point. I'm actually an academic by formation.
Oh, you see.
So the problem is that I could speak for hours. That's the problem.
Yeah, you have 5 minutes.
I have 5 minutes. I was expecting that kind of threat. Absolutely. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm actually very happy to be here because the conversation is very, I would say, stimulating and rich. And definitely the participation of Italy in this particular domain, I think, is quite relevant. And I'm actually very happy to be able to share my thoughts with you all and to share the experience of Italy in particular, which is, I would say, an interesting case study for those of you who are academics as well and want to look at it from this particular perspective. I would like to start by saying that food is not only business. It's obviously a variety of elements, and we have to take into consideration, as it has been evoked earlier on, the fact that we have huge problems to solve at the moment, like malnutrition, undernutrition, the fact that we have on another side, instead, obesity and excessive production of food. We have to find some sort of balance between the two. I agree with you, we need to find some solutions. I am very happy to see that the composition of this audience is quite correct in the sense that we need a multifaceted approach. We need a multiple perspective. We need a vision that is quite big, as well as the Italian one. Because I have to say that Italy, apart from the fact that I have to look at the list of
institutions. Just do it.
We host a number of institutions in my country which are obviously not only pride for all of us, but definitely give us the opportunity to discuss in a sort of choral way the issue of food. I'm obviously very happy to see Mr. Chu here, and is the representative of FAO, but we also host the World Food Programme, IFAD. We host other agencies like Bioversity International, the World Water Development Programme in Perugia, the Mediterranean Agronomic Institute in Bari, not to mention, obviously, many others, thousands, myriads of small institutions that contribute to this choral discussion, which brings about very important values, not only values, but also strategies and perspectives. I would like to say that one of the major things that Italy is focusing on at the moment is not only the Mediterranean diet. The Mediterranean diet is important because it has been, let's say, a reference point for many populations for centuries, not just for years, but it has gone through a transformation. But this is not something new in a sense, because this is not the particular element that I would like to highlight. The very important thing of the Mediterranean diet is that although it is more than 2,000 years old, it has gone through innovation, but it has kept its core cultural values, which are very important for all of us and are continuing to be a leading reference point for all the populations in the world, especially in the Western societies. This is one of the elements I would like to highlight because we have to reflect on this kind of success story. What is the reason of the success stories we are talking? This success story we are talking about. It is based on an approach that puts the farmers, the producers, at the center of the process. And by saying this, it's not only the fact that we leave the producers alone. We actually accompany the producers. We have gone through transformations that allow the producers to become the owners of their own process in a very positive way, respecting the ecological demands that are imperatives today, and not only, they also, obviously, in a sense, become advocates themselves of a new vision of agriculture, which is very important for Italy. For instance, for the relation with Africa and other continents, where most of the youth is not attracted by agriculture anymore. And therefore, the model that we are developing is something that can be an inspiration for all the youth and the new generations that can be employed in this sector and can also find some sort of satisfaction. Because we cannot forget that when you have a specific engagement in a productive activity, you must find some sort of satisfaction. You must see the product of your efforts to become something that really reflects also your values. Nobody nowadays is satisfied by just producing something. It must reflect the aspiration of the individual. I would like to say also that this is a very important thing, but in fact, Italy is much more than this in a sense, and I am very proud of saying this, because we obviously have gone far in reflecting upon the challenges of today. For instance, we are working very, very thoroughly on the packaging waste reduction. We have other challenges, like, for instance, how to make sure that the products are absolutely respectful of the health requirements. Also because if on one hand, as we were saying, there is undernutrition, on the other hand, there are lots of different epidemics and also including you know, different ways of interpreting diets that are really damaging individuals. And therefore, this becomes a cost for the health system. And the health system in Italy is national. It's free for everybody, including irregulars, I want to mention, sorry to say, but I'm very proud of this. And therefore, the health system must be kept and protected itself, because we don't want to waste our precious health system on something that can be easily prevented. I'm going towards the conclusion, because I know that she's looking at me. Although I would like to talk about this for you, for hours, because this is such an important thing. I can only say to you that you know that we have developed this very famous Made in Italy system, but it has not been built in a day, as Rome has not been built in a day. And it is based on a very gradual awareness of our position in the world, or our potential especially, and this is something that can be really become an example for other populations. And I say this because in my capacity of Minister of International Development and Cooperation, I have really focused very much on this with the comfort of a huge amount of professionals around me, and I come to the private sector, who are in fact creating a system which is based on the participation of many different actors. So it's a multi-actor effort, is a multi-stakeholder effort, and it is an effort that includes everybody with its own capacity, creating a system that is fully integrated. So when we talk about the private sector, we are not talking about a private sector that is only, let's say, independent, focused on making a profit, or just creating, you know, a value chain that is related only and simply to the production industry. It is much more something that becomes part of a value chain, which is much more expanded in the society, which reflects values that are shared by all the citizens, and this is why we have a system by which people are satisfied by our food production, are fully satisfied, because it reflects this particular approach that, as I defined as choral at the beginning, and I would like to repeat the word, it's a choral effort. So I just say that Italy is a good example. We are, let's say, we have been rewarded by our efforts, and we would like to share them with you. Also because the planet is only one. We have been listening to this during these days many times, and I think that the future generations deserve to see their aspirations realized. And aspirations really pass through the concept of food itself and also food production. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You know what? Listening to the speech, I... No, go ahead, because I will just... Yes. Well, we would like to have you in the panel, because I am curious what you are developing for development cooperation to make food systems that are really satisfying people as well as the producer and taking good care of the planet. That is, and I like the Italian food, like I think we all do, but it's also nourishing. We also need to nourish the planet. And I can invite you to come up at the podium, but I know I don't do it. Wait. It's recorded. No. I keep the micro. Sorry.
Ah, you're a journalist. I understand.
I am not a journalist. I'm the coordinator of the Scaling Up Nutrition Movement. Yes. You're lucky.
Okay. I'll just say, because you are asking a precise question, Italian Development Cooperation is very much focused on agribusiness all over the world. We have 20 priority countries in which we are conducting an immense amount of
Yeah, but you are such a good agent of your development cooperation. Yes. No. Yeah. And I don't deny that it's true, but I was wondering about the model and the secret of the model, how to make sure that farmers, food producers, food consumers, and the planet are nourished also in countries who are developing and hittest hardest by all this climate impact. Mr. Director General of the FAO, Mr. Cho, please come out. Yes, come to the podium. Give him a big hand. The gentleman is here. The gentleman is elected in June, and he started to work somewhere in August, I think, but before he was already working terribly hard because he's a champion of food systems approach, food systems that are nourishing people and are nourishing the planet alike. How are you going to implement it everywhere, because the world is desperate to get it implemented? So please answer the how, and also you have 5 minutes.
Yes, yes, I count my minutes or my second. Thank you, Chair Ume. And she is from Dutch. Yeah, definitely. I'm a half Dutch, half Chinese. So I'm even double square street. So, ladies and gentlemen, Professor Jeff Sachs is my close friend for many years. I'm very happy to come to here to talk with you because, as Honorable Vice Minister, she already proud of that. Yes, as FODG, I'm proud of the food from Italy and from Mediterranean regions. You know why? Because we learned from Roman times, 2,000 years ago. But also we argue how the spaghetti come from, and also pizza come from. You know, in China we have two pizza make one, and the Italy they are not a little bit in hurry and they make it in two. So that's a Italy pizza. You know, but it's very interesting. You know, Mediterranean food is really good for health. That's why FAO in favor support launch the Mediterranean food. When we talk about the food system, we have a two kind of system. Professor is here. He may be getting very more formal terminology. But we always talk about the small cycle of a system, from raw material production, processing, marketing, with your beautiful brand and the reputation, promotion, and let you eat more. That's your cycle. Yeah, you are very familiar with that. But that's, of course, related to the SDG. And you can reduce waste, reduce loss, reduce the something environment-friendly things, too much package. That's what I like Italian food, because Italy is not so much a fancy package. Natural, simple, like not like the Netherlands. Everything is a cosmetic, the fancy package.
You're not a benchmark. You're not benchmarking.
I was there almost 4 years.
You need to guide us.
When I went to a supermarket, everything is a fancy packet. And they opened very small things. So I make a little fire in this room. And so I know after that time, you feel a little bit tired. Yeah? She's a good, my friend, make a fire in this room. And then we should bring as a government, as an intergovernmental body, we have to look at another big cycle. That's something we are missing. Especially you can good at the talk in Rome, because in Italy, you have a 26 international organization. I'm humble and honorable to be the security chief. I got the special nominated by the Undersecretary General of Security. So I respond for that. So if you can divide this 26 international organization related to food and agriculture, you will make a big system. Let's start with the environment, soil, water, and so on. And then come the standardized production of agriculture sector. And the other day, we had a very long discussion with Westminster during my campaign. We need three chance: production, and usually farmers and UD, and then supply chain. Supply chain in a way which is used to be Europe and America is very good, because from the wholesaler, retailer, and from farmer store to the consumer store, that's your supply chain very well developed. That's why you had a problem now, because you are a big group of interest group which not allow you to change in a way, digital way. And luckily, I was from China, so we don't have that well-established logistic from wholesaler to retailer, and then we easily shifted to the digital supply chain. So depend on the high speed, high good transportation, good logistic, good cold chain especially, and then you can from the farmers, from F to F, from farmers to fork. Yeah, that's something really, even within Europe, you can, with from Europe, fresh products, within 24 hours, you can reach to the doors, forks in China. So there's supply chain. And third is value chain. Value chain is you have to share your value, not only money. Value chain is your consumption value, your flavor, your cultural value, with your production, with your producer, with your consumers, with your civil society. So that's what we need education. The other day I had a talk with the president of Columbia University here. You have to bring new ideas to how to create a new value chain. So, and then culture come, and then biology come, so we can create a big cycle of food system. And we need to talk further. For next year, we will have a nutrition summit in Tokyo, along with the Tokyo Olympic meeting. So nutrition isn't just the approach, not the end goal. End goal is the happy life, health life. So food system coming from food, it's save us health life. So that's, I think, and then 2021, FAO together with other RBS, and other organizations, we wanted to make food summit, so food system summit. And we need to keep less from government, politician, and the businessman, and the civil society, and also the consumers. Because now it's about 60 people living in the city, and more than 20, 80% living in the city. So consumer driving agricultural value chain, supply chain is the key for us. For businessmen to be successful, for academic to understand the real things going to happen. For that, if we're willing to cooperate all the key players at the government level and the private level and the civil society level, that make real food culture is something cultural and inherited. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Supply chain and value chain, good food, but taking good care of our planet as well. Yes. We have, right, very good. Well, I would say time for action. We have a panel. Please, panel, take the floor. You have come to stage. We have four panelists. We have Charlotte Ashbol, Senior Advisor of UN Global Compact. We have Gerbrand Havekamp, Executive Director of the World Benchmarking Alliance. We have Diana Holdorf, Managing Director and Senior Management Team, Food and Nature of the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. And we have Ben Valk, Lead of the Food and Agriculture Partnerships of the Rabobank. You all have a micro, but we first go and do an experiment. Because you are already listening for an hour and 15 minutes, and it's time for action. So we're going to do an experiment. My good colleague Edwin has a micro. He keeps the micro, but he's inviting you over there to come to the micro and ask a question to the panel. And I do the same here. If you have a burning question, which I can imagine after so much information, this is the panel to ask, because they are really going to tell us about the how. Who wants to ask? Come, please come to the micro. Then you can be also in the camera because it is recorded. I keep the micro. Are there more people? Are there more people? Come. There you stand. Sorry. Right here. Okay. Give your name.
Okay. My name is Judith Registe. Okay, my question is, we've been talking a lot about
what's
how.
What's your name?
Judith Registe.
Oh, right.
Why? Right?
Sorry.
Okay.
So I thought it was your warming up.
No. Sorry. So we've been talking.
Sorry? From where?
I'm from multiple different places. I'm originally from Haiti. Like, it's a long question. The way
representing the world.
It's a very complex question as well. So here's my question for you guys. We've been talking about health, the food system. We know there's like tons of processed food right now, and I've watched this moving across cultures, moving across countries. The health system in places like Kenya, Haiti, where I'm from, for example, where these processed foods are being dumped. What's happening in terms of what's going to happen with these tons of processed foods that are being dumped in the
here. Yeah. Edwin, please.
Hi, I'm Carolyn Villardi. I'm here representing my students and civil society. I have a question about agriculture, since it's the biggest contributor to environmental impact. How can we put pressure on agricultural systems to change to more sustainable practices? And how can governments, policy, and businesses cooperate with that?
Thank you very much. Crisp and clear. I have another participant asking a question.
Sure.
So this is kind of a couple of trick questions.
Is your name. First, your name.
My David Wilcox, Reach Scale. And in about a week, I'm going to India to set up scaling.
Oh, we're not interested in your
it's
travel
context,
scheme.
It's okay. Context.
So just.
Is it possible for the food industry to produce, let's call it a biscuit, that a woman could consume each morning, and she would know if she consumed that biscuit, she would have the protein and the nutrients she would need, so that whenever she got pregnant, if she just modestly complied with continuing to consume that biscuit, maybe every third day or every other day, she would be guaranteed to, or pretty high percentage probability, she would have a healthy child that wouldn't be stunted. Is it possible for the food industry to do that, number one? And if the answer to that is yes, why haven't they done that?
Right. That's quite something. Edwin, do you have yes? And I invite one more to come.
Hi, my name is Tanya Havman. I'm the founder of a company called Clé Mondial, and I'm also director of a company called the Food Securities Fund. So we sort of help mobilize investment into sustainable supply chains. I think it's still not that clear in terms of how we mobilize more funding and more investment to a very wide set of companies and businesses that were listed in the short list of companies. So, you know, there's some companies have a huge product mix. Others are privately owned. So it'd be interesting to hear in particular reflections of the person from Rabobank around what might be some ways that we can actually do that more.
Thank you very much. Panelists, did you note them down? Also this crisp and clear question. I have one more to go, and then Edwin, I invite you to also find somebody, and I hold the micro.
Thank you. I'm Rachel Thompson from the World Obesity Federation. So my question would be, how can we, all this responsibility we're talking about, all this call to action, etc., how can we do this in the context of reducing consumption? And is that something the food industry is actually considering, or is it something that we're just sort of talking about and paying lip service to? Because we need to consume less, ultimately, as the world, but we also need to do that in an equitable way. So is that something you're actually serious about? And if so, how? Thank you.
So, are you serious about it? And then, how? One more, Edwin? Not happening? All right, thank you very much. Ben, I think you should be able to answer the question on agriculture, and then we start to discuss further. Ben is the head of agriculture and partnerships of Rabobank.
Thank you, Gerda. And thank you for the question. So how do we unlock financing for sustainable agriculture and food production? Rabobank has an exposure of 100 billion US dollar in agriculture. That's 10% of our total balance sheet. We have just announced an investment in reforestation and sustainable agroforestry models of 1 billion US dollar together with partners. On one hand, that is actually just a very, very small part of what's needed. 1 billion, you know, against the finance requirement that was just mentioned earlier in one of the speeches, is nothing. On the other hand, to make 1 billion US dollar in new, innovative, sustainable production work is hell of a job, to be honest. So if I speak to my colleagues, they think we are overambitious. If I look at the SDGs, we are underambitious. So that's the key thing. People in our organization, when we announced this, said, this is once, but never more. That was half a year ago. We are now considering a second and a third similar initiative. That is only what Rabobank can do. Now, how do we multiply this? That's the question, of course. First of all, public sector entities should really act as impact investors. With 50 million of their impact investment, they can unlock 1 billion of commercial financing. So it's really key that that money becomes available, not just to one organization, but to a coalition of commercial entities. That's one. Second, I'm not really sure if the structure of the Bretton Woods institutions is still really fit for this purpose. So that could be something that could be considered. I don't really see much effective SDG financing coming out of these institutions. With all due respect, they do wonderful things, but this is important money, of course, that has to flow to the most effective things. Last thing I want to say is that we need to experiment with business models. We're doing this anti-deforestation. It's really, to be honest, an experiment. We've also done an experiment with smallholder farmer financing. The first initiative basically failed. The second initiative, a 100 million fund, is now on its way. We have to also be prepared to make failures. To be very honest, half of my initiatives over the last 5 years have failed, but the other half is in good shape. Thanks.
And in the second round, we're going to ask, what is the difference? What was the tipping point to make a project or an initiative successful? Or what are the failing aspects? Can you mention one or two?
Yeah, the failing aspects, we actually have a lot of learning to do.
Oh.
We, even as a bank, where we have risk management all over the place, we underestimate risks. In sub-Saharan Africa and smallholder financing, every single risk that you can think of actually occurs. Within 2 years, political risk, markets collapsing, weather risk, fraud, I don't know, currency risk, everything occurs within 2 years. I was not prepared for that. So that's just overwhelming, and it's a learning. Another thing is learning in partnerships, in effective partnerships. That's also very difficult.
Right. And what is a success factor? What is predicting success?
A success factor is a committed executive team.
Uh-huh.
And that's certainly there within Rabobank. that is extremely encouraging. Also, the room to make mistakes, go on, and be aware that we simply failure is not an option.
Yeah, Charlotte, you're from the world UN Global Compact. I was impressed by the four questions that needs to be asked in boardrooms. Does the company strategy contribute to health and sustainability, so to people and planet? Are we really focusing on economic, environmental, and social? Mm-hmm. And are we a good citizen, and is our supply chain? How many companies are already asking these kinds of questions in the boardroom?
Too few. So UN Global Compact just concluded a progress report and a CEO study, and it's very clear that despite all the excitement around the SDGs and so on, it's really very superficial what companies are doing. We can see that companies are certainly trying to embed sustainability in their strategies, they're developing policies and building it into their codes of conduct. But when we look at the impact that they're having on the ground, it's far from what we need to see. And we've asked them what they think is difficult. And it's very difficult for them to translate sustainability all the way down to their line of business. And very few are actually able to take it all the way to the supply chain. And many companies have still very much difficulties finding the connecting factors between the SDGs. So they take a very siloed approach. If I can just mention one thing.
Yes.
In the initiative that I'm leading on healthy planet, healthy people, we found that companies are looking at health, if they're not in the health sector, they look at health as mainly a responsibility for their workplace health department. But they don't think about looking at the potential negative impacts that they can have in the production, in the marketplace, in a supply chain, in a wider society. And so what we really want to see is that they view health as a leading indicator for their activities, because there are upsides there.
Do you have the number of how big is the percentage of companies who take the sustainable development goals as leading principles for the development of their business strategy?
So at this point in time, we can see that it's around 40-49% that are doing so, and even those are not doing it deeply enough. So for example, when we're looking at companies that are able to take sustainability all the way through their supply chain, it's actually only 27%
right.
that are doing that. So it's really an indicator that we don't have impact.
Yeah.
CEOs are still owning the sustainability agenda, but when we then ask them if it's also being anchored in, you know, their line of business and their marketing and so on, no. Then much, much fewer.
How to improve this?
Well, so what we want to see is that sustainability is really anchored with every member of the senior management team. So we're just launching a new framework, a whole sort of business management framework that really, in a very simple way, showcases all the different areas of the business where it needs to be integrated, all the way down to corporate incentives, how you promote people, how you hire people, your corporate finance, and so on. So it's quite transformational. Of course, the issue with that is that for many companies, the incentive for doing that is not quite there. So in a CEO study that we just completed, many of the CEOs looked at the SDGs as tomorrow opportunities. They don't view them as now opportunities.
All right, and how do we get these incentives right?
Well,
let me ask Diane. Diane, how do we get the incentives right? Because she's from the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. Also, all companies who want to make a difference. How do you get the incentives right?
Within the business world,
yes.
You mean, Gerda? So There's a lot of momentum from consumers in particular, equally from governments. So we're actually seeing big drivers, both from an opportunity and growth standpoint, as well as from a risk management standpoint, that are driving many of the companies to take even more proactive engagement on these issues of what's in their food portfolio. What are the ingredients in the food portfolio? How are they diversifying those ingredients? What's the balance with the micronutrient needs, which speaks to some of the questions that have come here. Now, most of our members are really big companies, and so they have very big footprints. They can move a lot, but a lot of the small and medium companies who are particularly in country and region, it's harder for them. They don't have the same capacity to do the broader work in research, innovation, renovation. So we have to find these trickle-down effects that will help bring those companies along as well through leadership standards and other guidelines. So there's tremendous work to hit the incentives where we have the consumer pull, where we have the policy drivers, but we need even more around the policy frameworks and the enabling environment to make that pull truly come through.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I will be back because they need to answer the question, but first we want to set the scene a little bit, and I also want to hear the voice of Gerbrand Haverkamp. He's from the World Bench Benchmark Initiative. Alliance, but you can correct it yourself. But there are so many instruments and so many data. It is so confusing. And some companies can escape, and other companies are just confused against what kind of benchmark they are reporting. Right. Do you have the solution?
Yes, finally. So one of the things that is lacking in all of this is accountability. You can show 1,000 frameworks, 1,000 disclosure standards, 1,000 data points, but if no one is using it to keep companies accountable, there is no incentive. So what we need, and this is what we bring to the table, is we will rank companies on where they stand in their performance on the SDGs, and that talks about all the issues that we just discussed. And by making these rankings public and freely available to everyone, we as consumers, as governments, as investors, as people working for these companies can create accountability. Because only through accountability you create the incentives for companies to act, because you do it on two ways. On the one hand, we can say that these are the leaders, but we don't really know. So there's not an incentive for companies to really lead.
You're speaking a little bit...
too fast, thank you.
Well, a little bit fast, but because we need to concentrate on what you're saying, because it is so important.
The issue is that if you lead, you do not get rewarded by consumers, you do not get rewarded by investors, you do not get rewarded by the regulators. And if you lag behind, you do not get held accountable by those same institutions. And that is what's currently lacking. There is enough funding flowing into the food system. All that funding that is outlined by the FOLU, it's going into the food system every single day, but it's misallocated, and partly because of a lack of accountability. And that is what we bring to the table with the World Benchmark Alliance, by creating this accountability, by making public and free available benchmarks.
If I would be interested, what I am interested in benchmark, but will there be an instrument to do some naming and faming, and maybe also some naming and shaming for those who are... Because encouragement is always the best. Naming and faming is the best to...
So what we have done, we have identified the 300 most important companies in today's food system. And many of those are World Business Council members, but there are 300 companies that sit across the world. And what we are now doing, partly together with these companies, is coming up with the methodology to assess them. We then ask these companies to provide us with the data, and we then produce a public available ranking for everyone to see at the end of 2020. That is both to fame and it is to shame.
Right, there you go. Question, food dumping without, processed food dumping, without having the health support that is needed to cope with the impact of it. It was a very serious question, and I think it's still happening. So Diana, can you say something about it?
I will try. I don't have a lot of insight into what the mechanisms are that are driving a lot of that, but I do know that there are real supply chain challenges and regulatory accountability challenges, as you were saying, both around the ingredient mandates as well as the distribution mandates. And those are things that need to be shifted. And when I was talking about how we help bring the smaller medium and more regional companies together along this journey. That's a really big part of that. But the big companies have an important role to play in making sure that their distribution networks are clean and getting to where they need to go. And importantly, doing the work around the positive nutrition and the transformation of their portfolios and the work around plant-forward food. There's a whole bunch of work that is underway that needs to continue to accelerate into market.
But my request to you, ma'am, is continue to ring the bell. Because I think it's still happening, and only
I
if
think there's real food
it
safety issues as well that you're speaking to that are really critical.
As long as it is brought to the table, we pay attention. So please stay focal on behalf of all these people. Yes, please.
I just wanted to make just one comment also.
Charlotte.
We were talking about corporate citizenship. And I think there are many companies that are, you know, are living under the perception that they are great corporate citizens. But sometimes they're not corporate citizens out into every detail of their business. So you might be a large US-based pharmacy retailer that is having a great brand on health, but at the same time, you're also selling tons of snacks and candy and so on. Now, you might have employees and other stakeholders that are saying you ought to remove them from your shelf, and it's actually a reputational risk. But the thing is, it's a huge profit driver. So the incentives are not there, but the companies might think that they're still great corporate citizens because they're doing so many other community-based activities. And I think we need to find new ways of holding them accountable for being consistent.
Do you have one proposal to think of?
Yeah, I know. I think, you know, back to what we were talking about, it's about accountability and transparency. And ensuring that, you have to stay true throughout everything that you're saying. If you want to be branded on being healthy, then you need to be healthy throughout.
Could you also think about tax incentives or taxation?
No,
definitely.
I mean, I could certainly think about that, but I think there needs to be both incentives and disincentives across the board for making sure that this happens. Yeah.
Then I would like to also have an answer to the question of the World Obesity Federation. Is it Federation? Yes. Your question was crisp and clear. It's about food production and about the impact. I learned a quote. It's not mine, but as we speak, the food system is bankrupting our health system. And let me add something that we also see, and it's exhausting our planet at the same time. So there is really, really a lot of need to do something. But can somebody answer the question?
Yeah,
Diane,
maybe
please.
I'll go to the push that you always have for us, Gerda, on the what are we actually doing. So I'll speak to what we, our members, are doing within WBCSD, and I realize that there's a much broader world out there than that, but I'll be clear on what we're doing at least. So within our project across food and nature, we've got a portfolio of programs under FRESH, Food Reform for Sustainability and Health, which speaks specifically to this double burden of nutrition and not feeding ourselves within planetary boundaries. There's work underway across our member companies to issue a reformulation report to be much more transparent about what is coming out of foods that are on shelf, but equally, and frankly, often more surprising, what's going in. What's it being replaced with? What are the micronutrient increases on there? A lot of that information is actually not publicly available from our member companies or any other companies. And so we're working with them and academics. We're not doing the research ourselves, others are, to help do that assessment across their portfolio so that at least we can get then a benchmark, to what is it that we need to continue to work on. That's one piece of work. We have another big piece of work that is on plant-forward food and the roadmap for how we increase plant intake, plant protein intake, and diversify diets. So that work is underway. And then we have another big piece of work around sustainable livestock, meat will continue to be in the diet? How do we ensure that what we're eating is sustainably grown? So that answers a broader range than just the single question that you had, but I think it's important to get to some of the what.
I don't think that they are happy with the answer, but I have an invitation for you, because you only want to have one answer and you don't. I'm afraid you don't get it today. But don't give up, because the importance of having movements, organizations, civil society, and institutions here today is that we can have the dialogue, because it's also on you to encourage businesses to do better. Only if you talk to each other and you first understand each other's language, because that's also something that is difficult, and we're not used to talk between businesses and civil society, for instance. But we need everybody around the table, not only to experience good food, but also to find the solutions. It's not an easy challenge. So continue. For instance, use the healthy reception for it to do this this outreach. And I would like to have an answer to the question: do you think it's able to create a product every day that if mothers use this?
I think he made it.
Sorry?
I think it's his cookie.
It's his cookie. Yeah, I think so. I think so. But yeah, I think he's doing a good job, and I think he was here last year as well. I recall. Yeah. I recognize his face. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't want to stand between you and the continuation of the discussion, but I would like to ask the panel what you want all of us to take home on the how to get food systems healthier for people and healthier for the planet. What do you want to take us, to give us to take home? Let me start with Gerbrand.
To pick up on your last point about the need to have conversations with each other, for benchmarks to be fair and legitimate and to work, they need to reflect best available science and societal expectations. And that's what you're voicing. So if you can join us in the conversations that we are having between now and June in shaping those methodologies, we ensure that it's based on science and your expectations. So my call to you would be to make yourself known to us so that we know what the issues are that you care about, and we can make sure that we find a place for them in the benchmarks.
And how do they do this? Because it's impossible to do this all during the reception.
So then we have to first have to be accurate about the name of the organization, because otherwise you Google and you can't find it. So it's World Benchmarking Alliance. And on that, you can find all of the information about the roundtables, where they take place, or you can just email us. My colleague Ido is here in the room. I'll be here for another 5 minutes. I'm sure you'll find us. It's 2019.
You are invited. You're co-responsible now to make this benchmark an instrument to really improve food systems for people and for the planet. Diane, what do you want us to take home?
There's so much, because the food system is actually very complex. I think that was well outlined in the Barilla report and certainly in the FOLU report as well. One point I will raise: we have very good science-based targets in the climate arena. We have very clear boundaries on the planetary issues for the food system, for how we grow the food. What we still need a lot of help with is getting to much more clarity around consistent dietary guidance. We've got a lot of dietary guidance, but how do we get to the real scientific targets that we can work to across all countries as big companies? So we're looking forward to having that to work against.
You will be never there. It's always moving. So let's go for the best available. Let's know, but I mean it, because you can continue to discuss forever what it exactly means to be sustainable, and then we do another research. We need research, but we also need to act.
We know the big things we need to work against.
Exactly.
Absolutely.
Exactly. And then meanwhile, let's learn, let's share the lessons, let's learn the lessons, but also let's speak out and speak to and with each other. Thank you very much. Charlotte. Mm-hmm.
So we just published this report. It's a leadership brief on healthy planet, healthy people. And what we're asking companies to do is, first of all, assess their health impacts across the value chain, negative, positive, set to the degree possible science-based targets, using health as a leading indicator, to begin breaking down their own internal silos, the silos across their sectors, move beyond just working in industry sectors and in professional communities and broaden their scope, and also take action to really work with the policymakers and other stakeholders to create positive ambition loops so it can actually happen. They can't do it on their own. They need incentives, disincentives, regulation, policy, and we need to find ways of doing that. And then finally, just one quick point. We need also to help the small and medium-sized companies.
Yes.
The large companies find it much easier to do this. The small companies, the more complex it gets, they give up.
Yeah.
And so we need to try and make it less complex.
I don't gonna ask you how, but you should have answered the question on the how, because small and medium-sized companies are very often very much motivated to be part of the solution because they want to invest in their society.
Yes.
Right, very good. Ben Valk, please. What do you want to?
I would suggest that each of our organizations would make sure to participate in at least one, and not more than a few, very high scale and highly ambitious initiatives. Because we really need to step up. All of us have a lot of small scale initiatives, that's fine. We learn, we develop things, we test things, but we need a few large scale, very high ambitious initiatives to move the needle.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. Give this panel a big, big hand. Because, no, stay there, don't move. Because they didn't know what kind of questions you had for them, and you were leading here. Please, next time you go to an event, ask for interaction, because only the conversation, only the dialogue, only being in there together can make our food systems both healthy, nutritious, tasty, but also climate friendly and taking care, nurturing and nourishing also our planet. So thank you very much. I give the floor to Jeffrey Sachs for a few closing remarks. And then we would like to say thank you very much for the organization. And then we are all together in hopefully a healthy and tasty reception. Jeffrey Sachs, you have the floor.
Thank you, Gerda, for wonderful moderating provocations, keeping us on moving and on track. Thanks to the Barilla Center of Food and Nutrition for all of the leadership. Thanks for the report team that has put today's report together, and it's very complementary with the Global Compact and with the WBCSD, and we're looking forward to the World Benchmarking Alliance. There's a lot of interest in this subject. There isn't one sentence answer because this is a complex subject, but it is absolutely central to both human health and planetary health, which we have heard repeatedly. I think the core idea that we have that duality of how to live healthy ourselves and how to keep the planet healthy is actually something relatively new in the global discourse. Within the last few years only has this dual focus been so clearly established, and I think that that is a wonderfully important development. We're extraordinarily lucky and I think honored to have the new Director General of the Food and Agriculture Organization with us. Thank you for staying also for the whole session. We know your leadership's going to be very exciting and very dynamic, and we'll cover these subjects. So FAO, I absolutely am sure, is going to be central to finding the solutions, to engaging with this industry, and to making the link of human health, food, adequacy, good nutrition, food culture, which is something of great interest and knowledge to the Director General and to the planet, which is obviously the running theme of this entire week at the UN General Assembly. I'll mention a few of the how to do it very, very quickly that we heard today. I think the supply chain is a theme which is going to be absolutely more central, and the co-responsibility along the supply chain. That will require new kinds of data, new kinds of monitoring, traceability, all of which is now possible. The digital age makes it possible to know, I assume, where every coffee bean comes from. You already know it, at ILLE. We watch the roasting being done. Every bag, you know exactly where it comes from. But now linking that to the planetary health, that the products are being sourced in ways that are sustainable. I know that the World Benchmarking Alliance will insist on that kind of information, which is not available now anywhere. You cannot look up for a company where it's sourced and know whether that is sustainable. A consumer cannot know those things in general. And that is part of what we need to be able to know. I think you asked the question, well, if it's so obvious, why isn't it happening? And one of the answers is markets inherently can be distorting. People buy things that are not good for them. They don't know, or they become addicted. One of the most addictive things in the world is some of the foods that we eat, and more of the research in recent years shows that some of these so-called ultra-processed foods or foods with heavy additives are somehow changing the metabolism between what our gut tells us and what our brain tells us to stop or what to eat and so on. So we actually have changed dietary behavior in ways that are now being scientifically elucidated. But this also means that the vaunted notion of consumer choice is not so simple. We're buying things that are not good for us. And we are going to need a regulatory framework that is based on good science also. We're going to need to restrict advertising. That's already happened. Don't advertise directly to young children for sugar additive products. In the United States, however, anything goes. And so we have the worst obesity epidemic in the world because our industry is out of control, because they buy the politicians, and therefore we don't have regulation in this country. So this is something that we're going to absolutely need. We're going to need new systems of land regulation. It is just not true what President Bolsonaro said this morning, that everything is fine in the Amazon. Everything is out of control in the Amazon, and we're going to need food. And by the way, what he doesn't understand is it's watched every day by satellites now. So he can say anything he wants. He can even fire the director of the Brazilian Space Agency, but we're all watching what's happening every day. And so we're going to absolutely need land regulation so that food is not grown in places that are unsustainable, high biodiversity areas, clear-cutting rainforests, and so forth, which is what is happening right now. Somehow the industry is going to have to work more closely with the epidemiologists to understand food impacts, because companies can't do the downstream work of knowing exactly what all of this means. The epidemiologists are scientists that cover population health, and getting the industry and the epidemiological community together, I think, is important. I would put in a strong call for gastronomy also. This is part of the joy of life, though we haven't put it that way for the last 2 hours. We like eating good food, I think our culinary experts, and Italy must be number one in the world in this, can prepare foods that are absolutely wonderful from healthy products, and this is something that actually we need around the world, culturally, locally, culturally desired foods that are healthy, tasty, and attractive. It's a new calling to make sure that we're properly eating in that way. And then finally, we have a date here a year from now. In the interim, we'll have the World Benchmarking Alliance conclusions. We will have our work in another year. We're committed to working with the Barilla Center for the coming year to deepen the work with the food industry. I'm sure we're going to be meeting at FAO during this year in key sectors so that we can discuss these conclusions in detail. We're going to be working with the World Benchmarking Alliance to at least put in our inputs of what needs to be asked, what to deepen, so that we can help create this pathway forward. But I think what is absolutely wonderful is that this project started with Guido Barilla saying we need to get on the right course and calling on his colleagues in industry to say we need to get on the right course. Thank you very much. That leadership is inspiring and wonderful. It's what brings us here today, and we're very grateful. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I have requested the panelists what I wanted you to take home. I've also one thing, because when Jeffrey said we need gastronomy, I couldn't agree more. And I was looking for the chef. We have we had a chef here, but I think she had to go, who is very active in social media. She's from the Near and Middle East. She's very active. She has 300 million followers. 300 million. I was already announcing proud that she had a 3, but she said 300 million, and she's making vlogs and sending messages that are encouraging women, young people, older people, etc. So my invitation to you is use social media to get the opinion going in a positive way. Encourage, from time to time you need to be critical, but invest in your opinion on the way forward, especially on the how. Thank you very much. The other side of the hall, there is the reception. Looking forward to meeting all of you, and thank you for participating.